There is one single manga page that terrified me in such a primal way that I haven't been able to stop thinking about it since. It doesn't have any monsters, gruesome gore, violence, or even a particularly traumatic event. It's something a lot more innocuous. Imagine yourself as a young child, not much more than a toddler, barely able to walk. You're in a park and following a few steps behind your mother. She shouts to hurry it up back at you and starts to walk faster. Your little legs can't keep up. You run and run, but you become more and more out of breath. Just as your mother starts disappearing over the horizon, you shout out to her. Then she stops, turns around, and looks at you like this. There's so many things this makes me feel. There's the shock and fear, of course, the standard horror reaction, but the fact that it's a moment between a mother and a child that we inhabit makes me feel something more. Guilt. This is a page from the manga Inside Mari by Shuzo Oshimi, a man whose body of work all taps into this distinct fear. There's no monsters, no aliens or murderers or ghosts in manga that live up to the mothers of Shuzo Oshimi. There are examples of a genre some people refer to as domestic horror, but I think that undersells it. Domestic horror media tends to be a violent father or a haunted house. And while those can be scary, there's something so much more insidious here. I started to call it mother horror, and it's a niche genre. There's only two other examples outside of Shuzo's work that I found. Let's dive into them and see exactly what makes this so terrifying. On the surface, The Babadook is a simple, formulaic movie. We follow a woman who, after her husband's death, is left alone to care for a young child. The kid's a troublemaker, gets into fights, breaks things, but most of all he has this obsession with monsters. He believes every creature from his bedtime stories is real, and it's his duty to slay them, even at an age where he should know better. It ramps up when a book called The Babadook appears. Big scary monster, wants to come into the house, possess, kill them, you know, standard horror stuff. The mother tries to hide the book, it comes back, she destroys it, comes back again. Meanwhile, the kid becomes so obsessed with this Babadook that he alienates all of his friends and makes life hell for his mother. But wouldn't you know it, the Babadook is real. It starts pranking them. Cockroaches come out of walls, violent images appear on the television, and eventually it does possess the mother. There's a finale where the kid defeats the big bad, saves his mom, and together they trap the monster in the basement. In the end, it's heavily implied that the monster is her dead husband or her grief, something like that. On the surface, it's a middling flick, and that's what most people seem to have for, but I prefer a different way of reading this movie. Everything changes if you imagine the Babadook as a personification of the mother's hatred for her child. And she does hate him, for a few reasons. There's the monster fixation. The way he expresses his masculinity for the first time and becomes a danger to others and himself. His eccentricity, which can be seen as neurodivergence. And she hates him for not being quote-unquote normal. There's even multiple times in the movie where the kid endangers her life. He shoves her, he puts glass in her food, and blames it all on the monsters. The thing is, a lot of this is a normal part of growing up. Kids are dumb and cruel, and that's just how they are. We find it difficult to truly hate a child. It's hard to hold them accountable, it's hard to see them as villains. And because of that, no one offers any sympathy to her. The other mothers ostracize her for being unable to contain the boy. At one point, desperate for help, she asks a doctor for sedatives that will calm him down so she can finally sleep. And the doctor looks at her with just so much disgust. In a traditional horror film with a spooky killer, the best way out is always to find other people. There's an expectation that society will help you, that others will understand, and that you'll be protected. But it's the opposite case here. These pills she gives her son are brought up often as a symbol of shame for her, of outside interference, of failure. No matter how bad being a mother gets, she's expected to bare her teeth and take it. So what happens if you bare your teeth long enough? The mother in the Babadook is visibly tired. Her eyes are often vacant, she misses part of conversations, her clothes are plain and her hair is messy because she has no time for herself. When the Babadook appears, it's almost as if she's free. The kitchen becomes more and more disheveled, plates pile up, the walls become grimy, the light bulbs flicker. But here's the thing, none of this is supernatural, it's all signs of neglect. There's an expectation of the mother to sacrifice herself and become part of the house, the child, to give up her life for his. So the more she starts to feel like herself, the worse the house gets. In Trial of Blood, another Shuzo Oshimi manga, a mother who has been seemingly pleasant for decades suddenly commits a murder in cold blood. And later in the story, we find out why. Because she wants to leave. Because she can't take being a mother anymore, and if the police take her away, she can finally escape. But that's seen as a failure too, as an evil and cruel act, the wrong choice. So what's the right choice? In the end, the Babadook is not defeated or overcome, it's trapped in the basement of the house. The hatred she has for her child doesn't go away, it's still there, simmering at the bottom of her mind. The boy doesn't change either. He will continue to be a source of suffering for her. Nothing really changes. The correct answer, the happy ending here, is not when the mother is helped or understood. It's when she sucks it up and carries on doing what's expected of her. You probably noticed that I'm being overly sympathetic to the arguably abusive mother in The Babadook. It seems to me like the movie wanted to be sympathetic as well, but in the end they had to play into horror convention, and so she ends up running around with a kitchen knife and kicking in doors. But there is another movie that does tackle this idea with compassion, and it's 2017's Mother. To summarize the plot, well, it's a heavy-handed metaphor for the Bible. The house, the secluded Garden of Eden, here's Adam, here's Eve. Oh no, original sin. Here's Cain, here's Abel, not anymore. We got the Bible, we got religion, we got religious fanaticism, we got the birth of Jesus, we got the death of Jesus. You get the idea. The interesting part here is the couple that live in this house, and they are personifications of God and Mother Nature. The husband, God, is a brilliant poet, a creator who can form meaning from nothing, from words, endlessly worshipped throughout the entire movie. Mother Nature, on the other hand, is an obedient housewife who maintains the home in the background and appeases his every whim. When Adam, Eve, and eventually humanity at large arrive to the house, God welcomes them as he would family, but Mother sees them as invaders. They break things, they smoke inside, they ignore every boundary she sets, and yet, it's her job to go cleaning up after them. They praise the home in one breath and they criticize it in the next. They sexualize her body and at the same time demean her for having one. She's treated by everyone, instinctually, as part of the furniture, and expected to be compliant to everything they want. This house is in the middle of nowhere, and furthermore, she never leaves it. She never takes a single step outside of her duty because that's where she belongs. She breaks down a few times in the movie. When Shuzo's mothers have had enough, they become murderous. And when the Babadook's mother cries, it's with a knife in her hand. And this all has a certain horror movie finality to it. It's a climax, where in a traditional movie, the protagonist would kill the monster in the last stand. It's a breaking point. But Mother is different, because there is no breaking point, and there is no resolution. Whenever she breaks down, she's given a single moment of space, before it's all business as usual again. Because what would the breakdown of a mother achieve? She still needs to wake up the next day, to make dinner, to accommodate the guests. It can't end. It can only get worse and worse. Never is this more explicit than in the ending. The mother, filled with more impotent, suppressed rage than is possible for a person to hold, burns the house, burns the humanity, and the entire world down. And it's still not over. In the final moments of the film, out of the ashes, God takes the essence of her being, the essence of a mother, an object, a trophy, a tool he uses to bring the house back, to fix the things others broke. The movie loops around and begins again. Because no matter how much this woman suffers, she's still expected to wake up the next day and carry on. So why is this so terrifying to me? I'm a guy, I'm not going to be a mother. Hell, I don't want kids, so I'm not going to be a parent either. The dread I'm feeling isn't coming from the idea of being the mother. It's the prospect of inflicting this on one. Have I been a child like this? Have I unknowingly caused my mother this pain and hatred? I must have. That's what kids are like. They have to make every mistake for themselves as they grow up. And so every parent sometimes must be filled with so much frustration that for a moment, they hate their child. I'm a man, wouldn't I have grappled with my newfound masculinity as well? I never got checked up for being neurodivergent, but I'd be surprised if I wasn't. And so wouldn't that have complicated things more? Have I ever made my mother this tired, this resentful? Have I ever taken over her life like this? I don't know, because she can't tell me. Because, like choosing a favorite child, parents aren't supposed to tell. The dread I feel when I see this Shuzo Oshimi page is not the fear of an abusive mother. It's the fear of a good mother, like my own, that I have unknowingly caused to feel like this. Thank you to our first patron, Owen Shannon, and thank you for watching.